With you, with no further ado, from the book of Joel. Y'all ready for the word?
Yes.
Amen. Ready to receive the word this morning. The book of Joel, chapter 2. I want to share a word that God put in my heart for the body of Christ. I'm going to read verses 21 through verse 23. Joel, chapter 2, verse 21 through verse 23. Amen. Congratulations to Sister Vanessa this morning and Sister Monique.
Amen.
On your Amen. Your baptism. Amen. Joel chapter 2, verse 21 through 23. Say amen if you would when you get there. Would you mind? I think we got some energies. Would you just mind standing as we read the word? Just a few verses. First, chapter 2, verse 21 through 23. Amen. The word of the Lord reads, "Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice. For the Lord has done marvelous things. Do not be afraid, ye beasts, you beasts of the field, for the open pastures are springing up, and the tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their strength. Be glad, you children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God. For he has given you the former rain faithfully, and he will cause the rain to come down for you. The former rain and the latter rain in the first month." Amen. I want to share with you, before you take the seats, I want to share with you from the subject, Lord, send the rain.
Amen.
Come on, say it with me. Lord,
send the rain.
Hallelujah. You can be seated. Amen. God, thank you again for your presence and your spirit. We pray that you would have your way. I hide behind your anointing, and I pray that you would give me clarity of speech, articulation, Father, and we give you praise and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, send
the rain.
The rain. I don't know about you, but it's been dry quite some time. Dry, it's been dry quite long enough. Amen. And I'm looking for God. I'm making a plea unto God this morning. Lord, send us the rain, the former rain and the latter rain.
Yeah.
Did you read this morning?
Amen.
Amen. And our text that we read this morning, we hear the words of hope from a prophet that's prophesying to a nation who has been experiencing divine judgment. The nation of Judah, Joel speaks to, and he understands that he's talking to a people who has seen nothing but destruction and barrenness all around them. The nation that had been under the divine judgment of God because of their disobedience now was at a place where the prophet is literally speaking a word of restoration and hope. The nation had experienced great devastation. You've heard the stories of the locusts and the cankerworm and how they destroyed the crops because of the disobedience of the people and the effects on it. But in the midst of that, God raises up Joel, a prophet, in the midst of this crisis, and he calls Judah to repentance and lets them know that God had promised them great restoration. Somebody say, thank God for restoration. God also uses Joel to tell the nation of a time to come, which we know as the last days. He begins to prophesy to them about things that were going to happen physically, but also from an eschatological perspective, in that what would happen when we get closer to the return of Jesus Christ. He was talking to them about a day when all nations would stand before a righteous God and would be judged for their actions and at the same time rewarded for their faithfulness. In chapter 2, which is where we find our text this morning, we see that Joel's message begins by telling the people in verse 1, he says, "Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound an alarm in God's holy mountain." Y'all may have heard that song before, "Blow the trumpet in Zion." But he's really telling them that blow the trumpet and let the people know that times of darkness and judgment is coming upon a nation who's not turned itself to God. But as we work our way through chapter 2, we see that Joel's message transitions from judgment to mercy. We see that as we work our way through this, that Joel begins to tell the people in verse 21 that there is a time for judgment, but thank God for the season that follows.
Yes.
Yeah. Says after judgment, God would bless his people. There will be a season of blessing upon his people. And then we navigate our way to verse 23, where we read this morning, where we see Joel addressing them as the children of Zion. In today's terminology, that would literally mean, it's another way of saying, church, listen up. I'm talking to you. Zion was a representation of God's people, which is a representation, or what scripture or what theology would call a type of the church.
Yeah.
He's telling them, I want you to rejoice in the Lord your God, because he's going to send you the former rain and the latter rain. Now, to understand what that really means, you have to understand that the former rain would be the rain that would be sent to help them with planting their seeds in autumn. You want to answer that? That's fine. Who's ever here? The former rain was the rain that would be sent to help them in planting in autumn. The latter rain would be the rain that would help them to harvest the seed that they had planted. Without crops, which they had lost, there was no food. Without no food, there was no commerce. Now, y'all can't zone out on me right now, because you're not going to get where we're going when we get there. All right? When they didn't have crops, they didn't have anything to eat. Well, when they didn't have anything to eat or crops to eat, they didn't have anything to sell to make money.
That's right.
And so when the locusts destroyed it all, not only did it take their food, but it took their ability to feed themselves and to make money to support themselves. It destroyed the commerce. It meant literally that their children would die of starvation. And that their cattle would die of starvation. It meant that they would have no income to live and to support themselves. Oh, but thank God for the word of Joel, the prophecy of the prophet Joel, when he says that while you may have lived through a season of destitution, and you may have lived through a time where you didn't have what you needed to support yourself and to feed yourself, he says, God is going to once again send the rain of restoration upon a dry and a parched land. He's going to send rain that you haven't felt in a long time. And he won't just send one type of rain. He'll send the rain that will water your seed when you put it in the ground. And he will send rain that will help you when it's time to harvest your crop from the ground. It'll be rain that will be with you from the beginning of your efforts until the end of the harvest of your seed. God, send us the rain today. Thank God that the rain in that time did not just represent the harvesting of crops, but it was a prophecy that spoke to what would happen when God would pour his spirit out on all flesh and bring spiritual renewal to his people. See, spiritual renewal would sweep through the land. Joel was prophesying this, and the people just knew it hadn't rained in a long time. So they thought only he was talking about sending rain to help them with eating. But Joel was literally talking about a time that would come that was in the future, way down the road, where God would pour his spirit out on people. That the Lord would renew his spirit upon them, and he would renew their commitment to him. The Holy Spirit, he was saying, would once again penetrate the hearts of his people, and they would once again live under the divine power of his guiding hand. This was a people who had lost their sensitivity to who their God was. And so they were not led by the Spirit of God. They were led by the passions of their flesh. And Joel prophesies and says, you've experienced judgment because of your sin, but there's a time coming where the Spirit of God is going to once again become your guide. This move wouldn't be limited to just the priests and the leaders. It would not be limited to just those who were called to a specific office, but it would literally permeate an entire nation of people. In other words, it wasn't limited to the pastors or to the elders or to the preachers, but it also would permeate the pews and those who don't carry a title, the lay people. It wouldn't be limited to just one church or one denomination or one group of people, but it would permeate the heart of everybody that names the name of Jesus Christ, the universal church. It wouldn't just be adults or people who had been around for a long time, but it would penetrate the hearts of children and young people. It would penetrate the hearts of not just the men, but also the women would prophesy, and the Spirit of God would be upon them. It would be a divine outpouring of the Holy Ghost, a fresh rain that would rest upon the people of God. It would not be limited to just one style or one look or one approach, but it would penetrate the entire fabric of the entire body of Christ. Some of y'all hadn't gotten it yet. Joel was talking about you and me. He was talking about the church of today, and that the Spirit of God would penetrate your darkness and bring light to all of your despair. He would penetrate your dryness and rain on all of your parchment. He would bring healing to your brokenness and strength to your weakness and pick you up in your fallen places and give you hope once again. Somebody who gets it ought to say amen. Lord, send the rain. See, Joel was saying that there's going to be a people, Reverend Maisie, who I've not met yet, who down the annals of time are going to experience something that they never experienced before. And they're going to be the beneficiaries of something that have been spoken since the very outset of humanity, and that is the divine penetration of the Holy Ghost.
Oh, yeah.
In all of this, we have to notice, however, that an outpouring of the Holy Spirit in our lives brings certain things with it.
All right.
This is why my prayer today is, Lord, send the rain.
Amen.
Because I wonder if the church we see today is the church that Joel envisioned when he prophesied, and he said, in the latter times, God is going to pour out his Spirit on all flesh.
Amen.
I wonder if it's the church he envisioned when he said, your sons and daughters shall prophesy. He talked about dreams and visions. I want to share with you today what I believe the Holy Spirit brings with him when he brings the rain. Somebody say
bring
it. The first thing he brings is he brings renewed conviction to holiness.
Amen.
I know some of y'all already thinking on me, he go preaching one of them holiness messages again. The second thing he brings is he brings an aromatic anointing. The next thing he brings is he brings an impenetrable love.
Yes.
And the last thing he brings is he brings new souls. You see on the screen there, across it for rain, you can see part of it. But he brings us the renewed conviction to holiness. He brings us an aromatic anointing. He brings us an impenetrable love. And he brings us new souls. Rain. I want to talk to you for a few moments about what renewed conviction is. John 18:8, Jesus says these words himself. He says, and when he, the Holy Spirit, has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. When Joel prophesied of a coming time when the Holy Spirit would be poured on all flesh, it didn't only mean that they would all prophesy, but that they would be people of conviction.
Amen.
One of the jobs of the Holy Spirit is to convict.
Amen.
The psalmist says in Psalms 32:3, he says, when I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away with my groaning all day long. I'm not quite sure about you, Pastor Joel, but I think I have, maybe I'm wrong, but I think I have seen some circumstances in the church where we lost our conviction to sin, where we understand what we're doing is wrong, but there's no real deep-hearted, deep-felt
conviction.
We justify our places and our positions, and we've made it okay. God knows my heart, and I know it's wrong, but whatever happened to the words of the psalmist who said, my body literally wasted away until I got this stuff rooted out of me? It's like the church has lost its conviction.
How true.
Things that used to convict us don't convict us anymore. If somebody makes you mad enough, you can say what you say and say, God forgive me for saying it, because you have in a head knowledge, you understand it's wrong, but you really don't have a heart repentance to feel sorrow for what you just said. I know I'm preaching in here this morning. We've all been there. But sometimes emotion can rob you of your conviction. But God, the Holy Spirit, is a God who, when you are wrong, the moment you enter wrong, right now, and speaking in tongues, but you got no conviction in your heart for your own sin. I need somebody else to tell me when I'm wrong, because the Holy Ghost pulls my card himself and says, you are wrong, and penetrates my heart.
Amen.
That's why we have to be careful about always preaching at somebody about their wrong. Let the Holy Spirit do his job. Nobody can do his job better than he can do his job. When I get tired of preaching at people, I pray and say, Holy Ghost, I need you to be God right now. There's nothing else I can say that will penetrate the heart of somebody, and I probably shouldn't have tried in the first place. But I need the Holy Spirit to be the God that he is and to touch somebody.
Amen.
That's why we don't fast and pray anymore. Because Satan knows he can make you hungry. You can't pray good. But I've become real stubborn in my latter days. I'm not that old yet. But my latter half of my, I don't know, 40-something. I've become real stubborn. And I've said, you know what? I ain't worrying no more. I ain't getting frustrated no more. I fall on my knees and I pray. I turn my plate down. And I say, oh God, if you can't fix it, that can't be fixed. I'm tired of talking. I'm tired of singing. I'm tired of singing. I'm tired of speaking. If you can't fix it, it won't be fixed. So all the energy I'm putting in, telling somebody what they ought to do, I'm putting it in prayer and seeking the face of God and turning my plate down and saying, Holy Ghost, you got to do it. Because if you don't do it, you're a liar. And you're not a man that you should lie. No, the Son of Man that you should repent. But what you have spoken, you will bring to pass. Let me tell you what conviction isn't. Conviction is not a guilty conscience.
That's right.
Conviction is not you feeling shame over your sin.
That's right.
Hear me now. You got to listen to this. Conviction is not the fact that you feel ashamed. It's not the fact that I feel ashamed when I wrong God. That's not conviction. Listen, most people are born with a conscience. Most people know they did wrong when they do wrong. You don't, just because they feel some level of shame doesn't mean that's conviction. Conviction is also not condemnation.
That's right.
It's not when you feel as though God's steadily waiting there to drop a brick on your head. That's not conviction. Let me tell you what conviction also is not. Conviction is not simply knowing right from wrong.
Amen.
We all pretty much learn right from wrong from the time of young children. Many people, hear this, understand the consequences of sin. They understand the consequences of sin, but they're not convicted of their sin. What is conviction? Conviction is to feel the weight of your sin. It's to feel the heaviness of your sin. To feel the darkness of your sin. It's to feel the disdain or dislike for your sin. Isaiah said it this way in Isaiah chapter 6. He said, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man and I have unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of an unclean people. Conviction is a personal sense of discomfort with your state of being. That's what conviction is. It's a sense that I can't continue to do this. It's a sense that I can't continue to say this. I can't continue to think like this. I can't continue to act like this. It's something that's got to change in me. Conviction is what drives you. You see, if you can sleep at night in your faults, you're not convicted. If you can rest well in your sin, you're not convicted. But it's when you lay down on your bed at night and God brings something to your remembrance that was wrong, and you have to fall out of your bed on your knees before you shut your eyes and say, God, I can't go another second without making this right. That's what conviction is. Paul says it this way in 2 Corinthians. He says that godly sorrow brings repentance. Don't say you're sorry if you're not willing to change. Ooh, that's pretty deep, but it's not deep. Paul said true godly sorrow is more than just feeling ashamed for what you did. But godly sorrow adds and brings repentance which means a change of what you do. Don't tell me you're sorry for saying what you said and then come back tomorrow and say it to me again. Don't say you're sorry for doing what you did and I still got to keep watching my back to make sure you're not going to do it again. That's not repentance. Now, I don't feel that way. I'm just giving examples. That's not repentance. Repentance and conviction means that you truly change your position and your posture. Let me move on. It also brings, when he sends the rain, he brings an aromatic anointing. Here's what Isaiah said about the anointing. In Isaiah 10:27, he said, "It shall come to pass in that day that his burden will be taken away from his shoulders, and his yoke from his neck, and the yoke will be destroyed because of the anointing oil." See, anointing in ancient times was a practice that shepherds used to protect their sheep, whether you know it or not. It didn't start with somebody putting oil on somebody's head. It was used as a practice for the shepherds to protect their sheep. And so what happened is there was lice and insects that would burrow themselves in the body of the sheep, and they would crawl towards the head of the sheep. They would find the ears of the sheep, and they would burrow themselves into the ears of the sheep and kill the sheep. And so what the shepherd would do as a way of protection is that they would saturate the sheep's head with oil, to what we call anointed, with oil so that the insects could not easily stick to the oil to get into the ears. And so that has evolved into what they used in ancient times as a way or a representation of anointing somebody for protection and safety. You see, anointing oil became really symbolic of blessing, protection, and empowerment. The word anoint has been used all throughout Scripture, and for us today it still represents that. Blessing, protection, and empowerment. And I believe, I don't know about you if you agree, but I believe God has blessed us beyond what we deserve. I also believe that he continues to protect us from danger seen and unseen. But today I'm asking God for an even greater level of his empowerment. Yes. To empower us as even greater witnesses. See, the anointing is what delineates the ordinary from the extraordinary. Yes. The anointing penetrates where nothing else can reach. Uh-huh. The anointing is something that is tangible, but at the same time, you can't touch it or see it. When a good word is preached, it provokes emotion. But when an anointed word is preached, it penetrates the heart and it stays with you. When a gifted musician plays or a gifted singer sings, the crowd is moved and awestricken with their gifts and the sound. But when an anointed musician plays and an anointed singer sings, the audience is cut to their hearts with the power of the Holy Ghost. When a believer carries the anointing, when you are a carrier of the anointing, you carry a mark that cannot be physically seen, but it's tangibly felt by everybody that you encounter. People can't put their finger on it, but they can feel that there's something different and unique about you, and there's a difference over you. That's why you cannot fool the anointing. You can fool people, but you cannot fool the anointing. You can be gifted, and you can be eloquent, and you can fool people with your gifts, but your lifestyle will tell on you every time. I've seen some gifted orators and some people who can move the crowd, but what about those who preach and sing and play and people fall on their face under the anointing of the Holy Spirit and their life is moved to change? We don't need more giftedness and more people who are educated. It's good to have that, but that's not what we need. Elder Dave, we need some people who can stand flat-footed and speak to us
Amen.
Don't you lose your mind.
That's right.
Because somebody done told you you
what
can preach.
What you say? Amen. Amen.
Right, Reverend Jean?
Amen.
That ain't nothing but some words.
That's right.
So what you get?
That's right.
So what you can do this good?
Yes.
The first thing you got to learn is integrity.
Yes, sir.
And how to live right.
Right.
How to walk right.
Yes.
How to understand conviction. Yes. And turn from your wicked ways.
Yes.
Turn from your sin.
That's right.
And live for God and live for righteousness.
Yes.
That speaks louder than anything you can preach. I dare not get up on Sunday morning knowing that I'm living like a hellion.
Yes.
And preach to God's people. But I stand
that's
on Sunday
right.
morning as somebody who's come to God first.
Yes.
And say, God, make me right before I come to anybody else. As some would say, don't get it twisted.
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. You can be as gifted as you want.
Yes.
You don't have no
that's it.
And a lot of churches are built on awesome gifts and great preaching, great singing, great structure in what we call in church leadership circles systems. That's you putting things in place to make the church run well.
Yeah.
All those things are very important. We have to operate with excellence.
Yeah.
But you first got to be anointed.
Amen.
First got to have the anointing, or it's of none effect. The church needs the anointing today.
Amen.
The next thing that comes with the rain is an impenetrable love.
Oh,
yeah. An impenetrable.
Oh,
yeah. 1 Corinthians 13:8 says, love never fails. See, when the rain of the Holy Spirit touches our hearts, it brings with it the ability to operate with an impenetrable love. Love that never fails. A love that loves in spite of whether it's being given in return or whether it's being reciprocated or whether the recipient is deserving of it. Impenetrable love is something that cannot be defeated. This kind of love is willing to love no matter what it costs.
Yes.
It's the kind of love that doesn't deny wrong, but it loves in spite of wrong. It doesn't deny the inconvenience, but it loves in spite of the inconvenience. It doesn't deny that there is hurt or that there is disappointment, but it loves in spite of the hurt and the disappointment. It doesn't deny that there is sometimes pain that comes along with it, but it loves in spite of the pain. Impenetrable love never fails, and it reaches the heart of the unlovable. In fact, Romans 5:8 tells us that God demonstrated his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, we were not loving him back. We were not reciprocating it to him. We were not deserving of it. But while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That is an impenetrable love. It's the love that Joseph had for his brothers when they had sold him into slavery after their betrayal, and he embraces them. It's the same love that Esau had when his brother Jacob had deceived him, but he decides to come back home to his family after he had been wrong, and Esau receives him. It's the love that David showed Saul in spite of the fact that Saul was trying to kill him, and in spite of Saul's hatred, he loved him anyway. It's the love that God instructed the prophet Hosea to have for his wife Gomer, who was a woman of ill repute and who was despised. It's the kind of love that Jesus had to call out for his disciples, who were commoners and not worthy to walk with him. They were fishermen and people who did not deserve to be in the inner circle of the master himself, but love called out to them. It's a kind of love that was willing to confront Saul on his way to Tarsus, while Saul of Tarsus on his way to Damascus, as he was going to torment Christians. But Jesus met him on his donkey and knocked him off the donkey and said, I called you for a great work. Jesus is the one comes with new souls. I have once said, I am unapologetically Pentecostal. But I'm never more Pentecostal than when I am winning a soul to Christ. It's said that there are up to 3.15 billion people on this earth that have not yet been reached with the gospel. God gave us the Great Commission. He said to go and make disciples of all nations. It's not his job to reach the lost. It's our job to reach the lost. And so I'm asking God this morning to send the rain upon his church again, that we will win new souls, people who've not come to know him in the full pardon of their sins. Now, I got to tell you, in order to do that, you've got to become a little bolder than you currently are. You've got to be willing to speak up when God gives you an opportunity. And I want to tell you also that there are going to be times when people will rebuke you for the things that you say. They will say you have no right to say it. But if you really believe that Jesus is soon to return, sometimes you just got to ask somebody, do you know Jesus Christ in the full pardon of your sins? Sometimes you can't be so smooth with self and think that you're going to find the perfect opportunity. Sometimes the perfect opportunity is just for you to say it. And if they get angry with you, that's okay. But perhaps you can plant a seed. We talked about the former rain. You can plant a seed that somebody later can come behind and they can harvest that seed that you planted. But the church has got to become bold and outspoken about our faith. And I always say that's not my calling. That's not my thing. But sometimes you got to talk to somebody that's in the gutter and say, did you know that Jesus can lift you out of where you are? Did you know that Jesus can save you in the midst of where you are? They might cuss you out and get frustrated and angry. The liquor might talk for a while, but the seed has been planted. And Paul said that some plant and other waters, but God gives the increase. That's where the anointing comes in. Your job is just to plant. You need to go everywhere you go with seed and just drop one and leave and let God send somebody to water it and let him bring the increase. You know, we're too institutionalized in church. I'm closing. I'm getting ready to close them in. I quickly corrected myself. We've become too institutionalized in church. We've got a system for everything. The outreach people are the people that do the Great Commission stuff. The worship ministry are the people that do the worship stuff. The pastor and the leaders are the ones that do all the leading stuff. We become institutionalized. Can I give you a theological lesson for one moment?
Come on now.
In the first century church, the birthing of the church, what we call the Jerusalem church, they had no youth ministry and no worship team and no outreach ministry. You know what they had? They had the power of the Holy Ghost. And everybody loved everybody. And the Bible said that people gave as they needed to give to make sure that the needs were met. Now, I know that's not going to hit everybody the right way, but I'm here just to preach to you the scripture. And I'm not against systems or ministries. We've got to do that because of the world that we live in. But can I tell you that you are responsible for every ministry that happens in the church? You're responsible for the children. You're responsible for those who are lost. You're responsible for worship. You're responsible for all of it. You can't sit in your seat like a consumer and get fed and not ever get up and do the stuff that God has called you to do, but you are held accountable. And when you stand before God, he's not going to say, did you just go to church? He's going to say, did you feed not that hard for me to tell people about my Jesus. When I think of everything that he's done for me and who he is, it's not that hard. Now, I, when I was younger, I wasn't as bold. Young teenager, or when I first, in my early 20s, recommitted my life to Christ, I wasn't as bold. But the more I understand of the goodness of my Lord, how could I ever be ashamed to tell somebody about Jesus? Even in the workplace, when people say, how in the world do you have the attitude you have when you see we got a crazy person that's overseeing us? And I say to them, and I give them all the prefaces, I say, look, I'm only answering this because you asked me. And I've got to tell you from my own perspective, from my own context, the way I'm able to do it is because I have a relationship with a man named Jesus Christ. And Jesus helps me to do that. I'm just telling you what I do. Because I won't be accused of not saying the name Jesus when it needs to be said. There's no way you can stop me from talking about